far, and I really want to see what they're able to do because they answered one laser with an even bigger laser
last time,
and we're going to see what happens. So we're back into bans. This is my last game. I'm lying. I am going to mention it every game. Kha'Zix was up, and they didn't pick it. What's going on?
In the last one. It was banned into game number one.
I know.
So we'll see. We'll see if they try to change it up.
They didn't pick it, and then they got their bug squashed.
Exactly.
You know, and so, you know, still Jax LeBlanc. So this is a position I think that if you're Ohio, you feel like you don't have to mix anything up. The Poppy ban and the Caitlyn ban from Michigan makes me think that they are now going to mess up their bans. You know, it'll change them up a little bit. Yeah. And there's the Vel'Koz. So now we are going to see a new game. You know, we are going to see the texture of the game. We saw Cat hovered. Kha'Zix is up yet again. Maybe they want to go for the super aggressive style that they were talking about. But Arun saying, you're not the only tank player out there. I'm going to see what you can do.
Yeah, we heard from Hai when he was talking to Taylor up in Ann Arbor that Courage of the Colossus is so great. And
really powerful mastery right now in the game. We are looking to tone it down in the upcoming patches. But for right now, if you've got someone who can use it reliably, you know, go ahead and use that strength.
Yeah, point-and-click snare, pretty good way to do that, I think. But now we get to see how Michigan try to change it up, because this is looking very similar. Maokai was first picked by OSU previously. The next follow-up would be if they take Alistar, but it looks like Michigan might try to change this up with the Alistar pick for themselves.
Yeah, Alistar has been in every one of the games so far, and it looks like he's going to continue that streak. You know, has been, I think it's actually been a little understated how valuable Alistar is. You know, he, and that's because I think the lane is more interactive, right? You know, there's not the healing that you're used to. You know, it's not just a boring lane. He's getting in there with those combos, and then while all these chaotic fights are happening, he's going up and he's smacking people. But that is the Irelia locked in for Ixen Creel. His next most played at almost 300 games, pretty similar to Jax. And he's saying that, you know, this signals to me that they are willing to go in.
Yes.
Because you are not going to just farm a lane against Maokai and expect to win.
So that's the big question now. In game number one, OSU did not end up relying on Nexvis. They all tried to be independent in lane. They tried to do their own thing. Didn't work out for them at all. Game number two, they relied on Nexvis during the early game. He ganked. He got lots of kills.
Yeah.
Do they go for something similar this time? Now that they see that there is an Irelia, who is probably going to try to kill you?
Yeah. I like the Vayne for the same reasons that I liked it last game. You know, true damage against Alistar, still great. Doesn't have quite the outplay potential on Alistar. You can condemn him out of the headbutt, which does kind of leave him high and dry. The Janna pick, I think, is setting up Ohio for a fantastic draft. You have two characters with straight directional dash moves that want to get in on your squishy soft targets.
Push them away.
And you have two ways to do it, right? You have multiple ways you're going to be able to stop them. In fact, if we want to get serious, every single person on Ohio's lineup gets to do it. But there it is, my boy, the Rainbow Scyther. Change is good, and Rhubarbs knows it. Value's also back on his Jhin, which did win them the first game. So I think they're, you know, aggression is the name of the game, and I think they want to try to overwhelm
Ohio State. What better way to do it than, hey, you're going to knock me away? What if I kill you before you can push any buttons?
Or what if we have four different people that are going to jump on
you,
right?
We'll just stagger our jumps.
Yeah, it's actually, I play a lot of Zillion, and it's funny because sometimes that character feels just as frustrating as Janna. You're like, oh, I can't do anything, I'm slowed. But the counter, in the same way to Janna, is just get a lot of people in there, because who is she going to save? You know, she's like, oh, I'm going to make sure no one touches Vayne. Well, if we're not going for Vayne, if we're going for all of you, you know, it's really, really tough to handle. So still tricky to navigate in these fights, and they have left this last pick up to Julius.
Yeah, so it's Julius and Nexvis. Oh,
whoa.
Hey, there they go, stacking the CC, stacking the mobility here.
All right, I need to see something big out of Julius to make me think that Ohio State can have an edge here, because Ohio State just said, hey, we're going to change up our Vel'Koz to Twisted Fate, which arguably works even better with the Vi, right? Easier to roam. And once you do get there, just layer your single target CC, layer that lockdown, and it's going to be awesome. Also, you know, because of Gold Card being a point-click move with a moderate range, things like Janna being able to speed up the people around you that much better, because 25 units, 50 units of range matter the world when you're talking about Vi ult, Twisted Fate, Gold Card, all of these abilities.
So here comes the answer from Julius. He's got 16 seconds left for that mid lane pick.
I want Fizz. That's what I want. I don't think we'll get it, But that's what I want.
Another assassin. Oh, gave us the Katarina hover in game number one. 5 seconds left.
I don't think you go for a standard mage. I wasn't impressed by the Victor. There it is. This is the the olden day reset comp, right? You want to get in there. You want to do a bunch of damage. And even if Ixen Creel doesn't get the kill and goes down, you're going to have two assassins going crazy in your back line while Jhin is just firing from far away.
Yeah. Doesn't seem like a very fun time.
Yeah.
But now Ohio State, they get to answer. They've got two point-and-click picks, plus Maokai, who can teleport and look for another. And then you've got Vayne trying to answer with mobility instead of sniping from the back. So in a way, Ohio State looking for something a little bit similar. Find someone out of position, pick a target, and just blow it up. And Michigan might have to be a little conscientious of that.
Yeah, I think Vayne and Jhin are the two strongest marksmen on this patch. And I think it feels kind of natural that it's now settled into two of them. These comps, I think, are much more close in terms of what they're going to do. I still think they're a little house of cards. I think they can fall over when one starts going. But I'm so excited to see this Katarina. There is a lot of single target lockdown on Ohio State. However, Maokai and Vi have to go to you, and Katarina can take you places you do not want to go.
Exactly.
Right? If you flash forward an assault and battery, now you're underneath two turrets.
Yeah.
That is not where you want to be.
Yeah, definitely. We'll see if that skill matchup is going to be how that ends up playing out. I mean, both of the teams are 1-1.
Yeah.
And again, we're seeing a different strategy out of both of them this time. I love how we're seeing this matchup actually evolve over the course of these games.
Yeah, and I think mental fortitude is going to be a big deal for the players in this game. You know, we talked about OSU has the experience. We've seen them flexibly hold on and come back with a great team to win game two and another amazing draft right here, right? We need to see if Michigan can hold on to that amazing attitude that they've had and if they can roll with the punches, because they have a great crowd that's cheering for them at home. They've got some great proactive picks right here. And if this goes to five games, I have to give it to OSU as an edge because they've been here before. You know, so a lot of fighting, a lot of trials ahead.
Yeah, there certainly are a lot of trials. We actually got a chance to speak with OSU about their preparation for this matchup.
How's it going, everyone? Mark Zimmerman here with the entire League of Legends team for The Ohio State University. How are you guys doing?
I'm pretty feels good man today, and I can speak for the rest of the team while saying that.
That's good to hear. So you guys seem like a pretty like close group of friends. How long have you guys been playing together?
We've been playing together for well over a year now, and it's been great.
That's good to hear. Is it fun outside of just like the actual environment when you're practicing? Do you guys hang out outside the game?
Yeah, we can hang out sometimes on the weekends, you know, just chill together like college bros. And me and my duo bot lane, the ADC, go and lift at the gym sometimes.
Who lifts more than
Jackman? Of course me. I mean, I'm the AD carry. AD carry carries support all the time, no matter what.
I always usually hear the support's the one who does most of the carrying and babysitting.
Nah, that's a rumor.
Okay. One of the things you guys said you've been playing around a lot together, and you have a challenger or like a sister team in a sense that helps you guys practice. Do you think that's better practice than other collegiate teams are able to get?
Yeah, I think it's a decent practice, especially if you don't have a scrim lined up with another college team. It's better practice than flex queue too, where we don't even know who we're going to get matched up. We could get matched up with challenger teams, or we could get matched up with a bronze five.
So one thing I see is interesting is one of you is missing this nice jacket. Is there a story behind why you don't have that with you?
I'm a really good brother, and I gave it to my sister, and she lost it. So I learned my lesson. Don't give anything to your sister, or else you lose it.
So I always like asking top laners, because top laners are like you, like this team mentality tank player, or they're like this, I'm going to carry, give me Riven. Which one do you fill in?
So before, when I first joined the team, I played like Fiora, Gangplank, and Yasuo, and I tried to carry Lord 1v9 every game. And over time, I've been beaten down into a tank player most games, and I just try and do my job and let the other guys.
You've learned to love the Maokai?
It's been rough.
He's a meta slave.
Meta slave. Speaking of non-meta slaves, this guy apparently doesn't play anything meta, and he'll play it until it becomes meta, then you'll drop it. Yep. So I heard Vel'Koz was an old name.
I played Victor like exclusively when he was bad, and then Riot made him good, and I was like, nope. So, and then I just moved on to like better not as good champions that aren't in the meta. So, you know.
I can't imagine your coach and team are happy with that mentality where it's like, I'm going to play the best not good play, like, characters.
Oh, you know, I love it because, you know, we're in champ select and I'm last pick and I'm like, oh, what are we thinking about the mid pick? And we're like, oh, you know, I think Lissandra's a really good pick here. You know, Cassiopeia is like a really strong mid laner right now, or it would go really good with my team comp. What about Echo though?
Just it.
And they're like, oh.
Locked it in.
I already locked it in.
Well, that's going to do it for us here. You guys have anything to say for your fans, classmates, anyone who might tune in?
Go Bucks.
Hi, Mom.
You're a big fan.
Go Bucks.
Got to rep Team Fee Belief.
We're definitely going to win.
All right, thanks, and good luck in the matches tomorrow.
Welcome back, everyone. Well, they did win that previous game. But it is yet to be seen if they can take this matchup as a whole. And as a team, you know, you were talking a little bit about the strategy for them, the fact that they are setting up these scrims with sister teams, with a challenger team as well, and multiple universities bodes well.
Yeah, I think we're starting to see them kind of come into their own in this series. You know, I'll be honest, I'm still a little wary of Pistoia's Vayne. Didn't have the most impact in the last game, but still, you can tell after that first game, you know, Peridot, right? Both played both the characters that he talked about. You know,
the
and it was like, hey, what goes well here? Echo? Not really. Sorry, I already locked it in. You know, but it is that kind of quirky style that I think is going to let them carry through, and they've been really deliberate since then. I just can't tell you how excited I am. Mecha Kha'Zix, my favorite skin on my favorite champion, and Katarina, the new Katarina, you know, has a potential to eat Twisted Fate alive.
Ooh, we'll have to keep an eye on that mid lane. Certainly will be a challenge to keep track of.
Oh, yeah.
The
There's going to be a lot of Shunpos right on your screen if this goes their way.
And we've already seen Julius go off. In game number one on LeBlanc, he showed, hey, I know exactly how much damage I need to kill you with a Flash Distortion.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I think even when he was playing, you know, he was doing his best, but out-comped and I think counter-picked is going to be really difficult for you to deal with. They just got some wards up here in the red, which I believe is where Rhubarbs would like to start. But they're kind of thinking about it. They will be able to track him, though, as I know there are no wards in the other side, so they don't know where he is. And here we go, the old preseason one. Let's just walk into the enemy
base
brush.
Check the brush, yeah.
Let's just see what happens and try to win right here. I will say, though, you know, talking about this Alistar and the impact that it's had, not just in its combo, I think Jhin and Alistar is probably a better lane than it was before. Because now, once you've rooted them down, Alistar has so much more that he's able to do. And here again, Courage of the Colossus trades.
Ooh. Bacon Seeker eating some damage. So is Pistoia. Wow. Good trade from University of Michigan. Just abusing that extra
value
range.
Grenade. Yeah, I really, really like 1Deeg and Value's teamwork. I've liked it the whole series, and I think they're doing a good job of showing how it's coming together right here.
Yeah, Julius wants level 2 so bad so that he can get that Shun Po and start moving through those bouncing daggers. As Ixenkreel already chunked down very low. There it goes. Gold card ready. Julius needs some trade. Goes in while he's eating minion damage. Peridot doesn't have Ignite, but he does have Exhaust, so he knows that this matchup could be a little scary.
Oh, no.
Gold card follows it up, but no Thunderlords. And Julius survives, but only just.
Yeah, so for those of you who aren't familiar, Katarina now puts daggers under the ground. Ooh, it may have all been a ruse. I don't know.
Barbs leaps in. That's gold card. Finds Julius. Insta flash. Follows it up. That's the exhaust. First blood over the wall.
Wow. And that is the reset team. So you were able to see it a little bit there. Yeah. Tosses out the daggers. And every time she picks up a dagger, Shunpo's cooldown is significantly reduced. And at the maximum rank, it'll be like 90% of the cooldown. So you'll see some really immediate shenanigans. And so, you know, a big deal is knowing where she can be at any moment. Ixenkreel going in for a good trade, which is good. It was looking like it was not going his way for a little bit, but now minions are kind of helping him out. But with that first kill, doesn't go to Kha'Zix, does go to Katarina. And Dom, she started the Dark Seal.
Yes, she's already got two stacks on that Dark Seal. Here it is once again. Julius baits it out. Eats the gold card, calculated, flash Shunpo, and Shunpo out.
Yeah, uses the Shunpo and then immediately Shunpos to Rhubarbs to kind of dodge a little bit of the turret action there. Ixenkreel has
solo killed a rune in the top lane. Wow. Yeah. Okay, so if you let people get their mains or their second mains.
Pretty good.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I mean, honestly, Jax and Aurelia are so similar. They were kind of the they were the top laners of kind of the old guard era. And so if you know how to play one, you very likely know how to play them all. And he has put on the games to kind of back that up. Nexus is coming back, but he isn't a ward. But Kha'Zix is here. They could actually turn this into a fight, make them think that he doesn't know what's going on.
Yeah, Peridot already used his flash, passes the gold card once, but settles back onto it in order to make sure he's safe. Julius will just clean that up. Gold card. Oh, still eats the damage, though.
Yeah, I think, you know. Oh, and here we go. Here we're going to see it. Oh, we saw it was just a little bit of this thing. You know, true damage is pretty crazy, but you see a minion's going pretty far here. So he's probably going to use his Q, dash Q.
Yeah, get the minions under the turrets. So he's got the cannon minion.
Is he just going to...
He's taking
so much of the minion aggro right now. He's actually taking a considerable amount of damage, but he probably just... I could see him... Wow, he just walks up and does it.
Yeah. Oop, dashes to follow up and flashes to get out of turret before the next hit. Ixenkreel just gets the solo kill due to a mistake from Arun, not respecting that.
Well, I think, you know, we would have to know what his passive was at. I wasn't really keeping track of it at the time. It's possible that he knows, well, I'm in danger. I need to use my passive to survive, so I'll use my root to hopefully get him under turret. But it was just not timed enough. I think, you know, the mistake is getting so close to Aurelia to let her stun you in the first place, because the damage that champion can do is so surprising. And people actually switch up their build order in terms of leveling so often that it can actually be really tricky to play because you don't know which abilities to be mindful of.
Do I get health because she's going true damage, or do I go armor because she's going to be dashing on my face?
Right, yeah, there's lots of different ways to play the match. A very flexible champion, and she's already got some daggers and swords. Exactly what you want to see.
Yeah, so things looking good right now for University of Michigan. Seems like they're coming off to just as fast a start, if not faster, than Nexivus was in game number two. Still, level six actually now has only just been picked up. That's the gold card. Julius might look for Peridot, gets the bouncing dagger, Shunpo one, and gets the kill and out before the turret can kill him.
Whew! That is... Yeah, Katarina is a hell of a drug. That character is wild. And that is the thing where you do not want to let Katarina get level 6 on you, because back in the day, you know, it was like, oh, she's going to shun put me in Death Lotus, but if I have my stun, I'm going to be okay, right? You saw she used the anticipation, I believe is what it's called.
Preparation.
Okay.
Yes. Regret.
Buddy.
Yes. Might not have respected the turret there. Okay, a little bit of silliness going on.
Pustoy is getting hit against the wall.
Snare. Pustoy goes in, though. Value gets knocked back. That's the exhaust. Fourth bullet does some good damage. That's heal being used, and 1D finally backs off.
Yeah, so that's two summoners for two. Flash and exhaust on Alistar into exhaust heal on the enemy bot lane. But yeah, like I was saying, we're going to see it again here, right? So look, hit six, gets the stun. Uses prep, walks up to get the other one. And this is, I think, actually really important, because I think a lot of people, what they like to do is prep where they are. Shunpo's first, and then just walks up to get the second dagger, because he knows that Twisted Fate's gold card is not up and will not be up for quite some time. I don't know. I love this new Katarina. I think she's super cool. But it is... If you know how to play the LeBlanc matchup from before, as we saw, Peridot still did a decent job of holding up to it. Katarina is a very, very different match.
Oh, gets the gold card, looking for the reset. Can she find it? She can! What are you doing, Julius? Six stacks already on that dark seal.
It is the darkest seal.
Yes.
This has ever been purchased.
This is a dark timeline for OSU right now. With how this game is going.
I am so enamored. I mean, you know, Ixenkreel making a big play and then getting a little ahead of himself. But otherwise, Michigan firing back, you know, and saying, hey, OSU, nice game.
Yeah.
Try this one. Right. And they really are kind of going blow for blow. That said, Arun is not too significantly down on this Maokai right now. And if they can stem the bleeding, I think comp-wise, it's going to be difficult for Kha'Zix to get ahead. Right. However, if they keep running the table like they're doing right now and they can really open up the map, this will be a short game three.
Uh-oh, Peridot's back in the mid lane, level six, but Rhubarbs was by that Raptor camp. He's got a ward over the wall that will spot out. Nexivus gets a lot of damage. This is Kha'Zix, another solo kill for Michigan.
Yeah, I think You're seeing something right there. His evolution on his Q now gives him 60% cooldown reduction on his Q if it hits an isolated target. Now, it does do a little less damage than it did, but it has higher uptime, and so when you get jumped on by Kha'Zix, you need to have a way to get unisolated very quickly, or there's going to be a lot to go for. And Pistoy kind of getting attacked on.
Yeah, 1D stacking up that trample as best he can, but not able to get the stun off as they're just trying to harass OSU in this bottom lane. But I mean, the two assassins are off the ground.
Oh,
the
curtain here it is.
Has been called. Minions are getting in. Bacon Seeker trying to body block those turrets. Isn't the best way to do it actually to walk in to value? Because then you increase the size of your hitbox relative to the size of your allies in the back?
You can do that. I think they probably had a thought that Kha'Zix was nearby.
Maybe
they don't want to walk up into Alistar, because then
you get knocked up and Kha'Zix
It's like now
up.
You're getting hit by curtain call, but you're now close to him afterwards, which I think is a little dangerous. You know, not a disaster by any means, and this is something that happens often where you get so close to setting up a play that you might be a little too close to it. Now, as Nexivus walks up with Vi, you know, they're kind of still in that mindset of, oh, let's keep pressing up. Looks like they're pulling back a little bit right now. Bot lane not being as eventful as it has been in games past, I feel.
It seems like Value and 1D are content to just sit back and catch gold in an even matchup. They've got vision all over OSU's bottom side of the jungle. So really, the fact that they know their assassins are already getting off probably can give them a good reason to sit back and, hey, just don't die. Yeah. We'll do work in the meanwhile.
That said, I want to call it again. Nexivus has been the master of jungle pathing, and despite being solo killed in his own jungle, is even on experience. I wouldn't be surprised to see him get 9 first, honestly. Still maintaining a CS average. Kind of knows where to be and when to be there.
Yeah.
You know, except for the murder. That was
crazy. Was a little tragic.
Yeah, you don't want to be there. But
sometimes Kha'Zix just gets a kill. As he does.
Right. Well, I think, you know, Hai, you even heard Hai talking about it as Kha'Zix now snooping around might just go over the wall. Uh-oh. I'm so scared for this Twisted Fate's life.
I know. He's got Exhaust and Flash. But
yeah,
the question is that enough? Plus a Negatron Cloak.
Ignite plus the burst from two champions, I think, is the difficult part, right? If it was just one, you can probably survive. When it's two of them, right? It's you know, such a difficult thing to navigate. Is, you know, you would have to stun one, exhaust the other, and Flash. Right? It's very, very difficult to deal with. But, I think, you know, considering these junglers, I think Nexivus now needs to make a play. However, the point about the jungle experience is, you know, if you consider Rhubarbs, who was put behind last game, the deficit was wide.
Yeah.
Right? You know, 6 versus 4. Nexivus not falling behind too much and letting these things get to him could be what allow OSU into the game.
I mean, for the past few minutes, there haven't been any solo kills, remarkably.
Yeah, I know. With now Gunblade Kettering, that's actually interesting. I think the jury's still out on what the build is.
Yeah. I've always been a fan of the Sork boots in lane for more mobility, and then Ludens, just because the bonus burst from the Ludens is so much.
Yeah, I think a kind of subtle change that was made somewhat recently is Gunblade's active now doesn't have a travel time. It's just instant.
Oh, just right? A zap.
Yeah, it's just a zap and a slow, right?
Yep.
And so I think when you're trying to do as much instant damage as possible on Katarina, shunpoing onto them, slowing them, shunpoing again, you know, it can cause a lot of trouble.
All righty, Julius now putting some pressure on this mid lane tier one. He's got some help from 1D, and Rhubarbs has found Nexivus. That is the target. Not even an assist for Julius as they pull the trigger. I spoke too soon. There was, in fact, a kill. I was about to commend OSU for slowing the game down and not giving up more kills. But Michigan show that they know how to continue to chase their advantage.
I'm not even going to hide it. I love Kha'Zix. I love the Kha'Zix play. Well, because it's, look, we might hit a time in this game where these assassins are going to do some real gross damage. But I think the plays that you have to set up to get where you want to be, right? Like, that was such unique coordination, right? Like, moving up right there, the flash headbutt pull from the Alistar. These are trade-offs that, you know, you're going to be weak for the next little bit because you're going to lose summoners, but I don't think that OSU has an answer just yet. You know, they're like, I guess we should just keep scaling, and I don't know that that's going to work.
They've got got that Vayne and Twisted Fate, but just can't quite seem to get themselves off the ground. Michigan might not even give them an opportunity, as that Cloud Drake and another Cloud Drake spawning after means very mobile assassins. Speaking of which, Julius roaming around, getting a little opportunistic, looking for a kill, but not able to find anything.
Bacon Seeker, I think, has been somewhat underrated. I think throughout the series, or at least, you know, I don't think we've talked about him quite as much, but, you know, even on two games as Alistar and now as Janna, has done so much to keep Pistoy safe, as, you know, at least in the laning phase, you know, has done a great job of nullifying what could be yet another advantage. And so, you know, even though Cloud Drake is going to make it easier for them to do it without resource loss, you know, these assassins have visited bot lane a couple times now, and to no avail.
Yes.
You know, top lane, you know, God forbid when they start showing up there, but also been relatively quiet past the very beginning. And so it's really focused on the jungle and mid area, which means that now the Bacon Seeker feels a little freed up to go be there. You can probably try to stop the bleeding on a macro level with about 3,000 gold now to Michigan.
And you could take a look at the wards being placed from OSU to keep an eye on that, all across the river on that bottom side, all across the jungle on that bottom side, and even some wards to keep an eye on the topside river for Julius, just to make sure, hey, if this Katarina goes somewhere, if Rhubarbs tries to walk through, we're going to see him.
I think it's actually really smart, you know, and I like your point about the vision line, because if you look at the two places that Nexivus has died this game, they are now heavily warded, right? Like, I think they are very clearly trying to say that if another one of us goes down, it's going to be the mid lane, and hopefully we'll be able to stop right after that. Silver Bolt falls off. This is a dangerous place to be, because you don't want to walk up into that.
Uh-oh. They're looking for some action in the bottom lane. Peridot chases forward. Value uses his flash and heal early. Exhaust still able to get the kill before he finally goes down. Now 1D looking for something. There's not going to be any assistance. Meanwhile, first turret will go down in trade. That is two kills for OSU. But here come the assassins. They're walking through a ward line.
Ooh, if Vi can meet them on the way, this could be huge.
Oh,
they don't know where Vi is.
It's a gold card, flashing forward onto Rhubarb. Junpo looking for one, gets the reset, looking for two. Oh, but can't quite get enough for the second, and Rhubarbs will survive as well.
And there's another fight up here, but I think just a lack of communication, that could have been so good. It's difficult because these characters have such an ability to split up from one another, right? Oh, and it looks like they're trying to go back
Julius
in.
Julius tries to dive, but Nexivus punishes him for it. And unfortunately, you are no longer isolated when next to turrets, so Nexivus survives.
All right, Julius feeling himself a little bit. Everybody gets one.
Yeah.
You know, I think you've kind of been going off a little bit this game, but, you know, I think the ability for Katarina to go in is something that OSU is going to need to react to, right? You know, I think in the past, Shunpoing in means if I don't kill someone,
it's going to be trouble.
Yeah, if I don't kill someone, it's going to be trouble. So here we are. We're going to see this again. And shout-outs to Bacon Seeker, actually, walking up and interrupting the headbutt that would have stopped him. That said, it ends with his own death, but they are able to pick two up here.
Continuing to chase it down, 1D running away for his life. Meanwhile, the assassins did roam down, and while this replay was going on, the top tier one did go down. Ixenkreel finishing off his Trinity Force brings it to two turrets to zero. Now that Cloud Drake is spawning in 2 minutes.
Oh, and there is a Serrated Dirk on this Aurelia.
That actually is. Yes, it is.
Yeah. And so this is interesting because, you know, lethality now is the new thing.
Yeah.
It's basically armor pen, but it's worse against lower level targets because it scales with your opponent's level. So, but it is a really good bet if you are keeping even or if, you know, you want to take down someone who's gotten a little out of hand, it's going to do just fine. However, the interesting thing, stop that destroy.
It's snare. Julius actually shows up bottom, looking for an entryway, but Nexivus shows himself as well in the top lane. They will actually go in and get the kill, and they get another one in the top lane. That is reset, Sidri.
Katarina is
having a field day here. There goes yet another one. Twisted Fate getting in. Julius is the target. He's stunned, but he's
got the aggro.
And Value can't finish it off for another one as the minion wave gets cleared. They're looking for it. They're thinking about it. Julius decides to walk out. Gold card for more damage.
They were trying so hard to dodge the the daggers on the ground,
yeah,
that they clumped up too close, and literally just the bounce of Katarina's Q ended up taking out Pastoy. This is, I think we can now officially say, kind of a disaster for OSU. They need something right now if they're going to be able to pick this one up. You know, Nexivus was there, right? Yeah. He was there to stop the play. And when you commit that many resources and you still don't stop the play, you know, something else has to happen. You have to work something else into here because, you know, Irelia and Kha'Zix are also going to take down Maokai.
Yeah, they also got Rift Herald in the meanwhile. Here's that play in the bottom. You can see Julius coming around, trying to skirt around the vision as they engage onto Pastoy, snare him up, and the fight breaks out. Stunts. Yeah. Meanwhile, on the other side, you did see that kill onto Arun. Taking a look right there. Yep, the Bouncing Dagger.
Bouncing Dagger ends up getting it. And then such a cool stop, you know, like he kind of immediately blinks out of that. Look, I don't care who you are. That's pretty cool. And then, you know, they aren't able to end up finishing off Nexivus here, but they are able to survive, and that's just the level advantage. They're so ahead at this point that, you know, Twisted Fate.
Oh, we're coming right back into a fight. Three people are dead. Oh, boy.
All right, I feel like this is going to happen all game. We're going to be in one replay, and then the next replay is going to happen at some point.
Yeah, so 20 minutes in, that's three kills now. And looks like Drake actually spawned again, and OSU managed to take it, so that might have been what happened, and Michigan cleaned it up.
Uh-oh.
Ixen Creel looking for one. That's a knockup into the back line. Julius looking for an opportunity to follow up. Saves the preparation. Nexivus holding on to the Assault and Battery, waiting for that Shun Po. And that's a stun now, and they will escape with their lives. But University of Michigan are not done. They are looking for turrets. Mid-tier 2, 21 minutes in, and bottom tier 2 at the same time.
Hey, Kha'Zix, what's up, man? You know, just, I'm taking
this
turret, too.
I love his leaping animation on that skin, especially with the wings, how they flap uselessly behind it.
Look, I gotta say, after having just missed that replay, I'm a little bummed about what happened in the mid lane. It was like, I mean, it was an awesome defense, but it was like, wow, really? No one's dead at that point? Is that what's happening? Maybe all their kill moves are
to be fair, yeah. Like, OSU are showing a very solid defense in this. Here's actually a replay. I think we're gonna get a chance to see what's going on. Oh, Ixen Creel teleported from behind with the Rift Herald buff.
Yeah, Nexivus has just soloed the dragon, something he's already done once before. And yeah, they just kind of got exploded.
Yeah, pick up a few kills. Let's see what the third one was. Didn't get a chance to see
that. I think Maokai was dead somehow at the beginning of that clip.
Oh, yeah. Oh, okay. That makes sense.
Yeah, he just walked around in the forest and kind of got bodied.
As you do, yeah.
Yeah, you know, that's how it happened.
The old Maokai things. Okay, so 22 minutes into the game, 8,000 gold, one tier 2 turret remaining. Dragons have been taken and controlled. What is... That's a Rylai's on Katarina.
Oh, yeah.
I was going to ask, like, what can they do, but...
It's going to be really hard for them to get away from Katarina. I mean, and I think they have kind of the right idea with at least you have Exhaust, you have Twisted Fate, you're going to be able to stun them and stuff like that. But I think, you know... Oh, Lord. Oh!
Ixen Creel goes
Man, come
in.
On.
That's silly. And, oh, they're going for another... They've got it. Okay, chasing now on to Nexivus. There is no Assault and Battery. Julius gets knocked out, Shun Po, and that's a triple kill. Julius, survives, and now they're going to take the turret. Meanwhile, the rest of Michigan are pushing on the opposite side of the map for the final tier 2.
So how many games has Rhubarbs played of Kha'Zix again, Dom?
I'm not 100%. I believe it's somewhere in the ballpark of 830,
yeah,
if I recall.
This season.
This season alone.
Yeah.
Yes.
Pretty, a lot, for sure. And you know, I don't want to make it sound like we're just, you know, going off for Michigan here, you know, but I have to say, the previous two games, I won't lie, I thought there was a clear path to victory for the losing side. There was something that they could do. This game, it is just falling apart at the seams, and I think that this is awesome by Michigan on a strategic level, right? This is actually pretty different from a lot of the other teams that you were having so many assassins. Look at this.
Finding them in the jungle.
We missed it in the play because Ixen Creel was just like, whatever. I don't need to care about this game. This is just kind of going on.
Just going for another.
You know, it's just kind of wild to see this. And I think, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if next draft we actually don't see a really aggressive team comp from them.
Yeah.
Right.
So OSU are blue side right now. They're going red side, which means they get the opportunity to counter pick and get final pick for Peridot. But there is just so much to ban now. Nautilus, apparently Katarina, Kha'Zix, Aurelia.
Right.
And there's too much.
And I think there's an important thing to note here, which is the game that Michigan has lost so far. Kha'Zix is up and they didn't take it.
Yeah.
Right? Do you try at all to take the gamble that they won't take it again? Right? You know, like because they feel pretty stretched to their limit. They're not going to give the guy Jax. They're not going to give him LeBlanc or Nautilus. Mm-hmm. And you have to think that with the proficiency that they showed on those champions before, now we're at the point where there's too many things to ban. So OSU, you had a great strategy. I think you had an amazing draft, right? If you want to follow your keys of the game, you got to switch it up one more time. Mm-hmm. One or two more times if you want to stay competitive in this.
Oh, that's a knockup.
Man,
Rhubarbs.
Damn.
That takes a lot
of vacancy here, which is awesome.
Ooh, might be regretting this. Isolated from the rest of his team, he dies. Here comes the rest of the damage, trying to chase it up. That's without a Katarina. That's split push. Rhubarbs will finally die, shut down by Arun as Value opens up with Maokai right behind him. Meanwhile, Julius flanked and cleaned up the final kill.
Yeah!
Arun is going to clean this up, though. That is an ace for Michigan.
I'm going to make one comment here, which is, you know, I have played through every kind of tank meta that there is, you know, and it always feels crazy because it's like, oh, everyone's tanks and you're doing it. But, like, you're witnessing a Katarina able to kill a Maokai that's able to kill a Jhin. You know, it feels like there's a circle of life happening right now. You know, the food chain is definitely in effect. But, man, overwhelming force. You know, they picked their strat and they really have gotten it down. Oh, that's a death cap on the way. If you remember when you saw what it looked like for, I think it was Janna, ate a bouncing blade with her shield up and then the W.
Damage.
A lot of damage.
Yeah.
I think we're going to see some crazy runs. So we start off with an awesome kind of preemptive thing. Nexivus actually makes himself isolated with that. He was actually close enough to Janna and then brings himself a little closer. Kha'Zix is exhausted for like 10 years or something. Like I think he got re-exhausted by Twisted Fate. And Arun, you know, shout out to him trying to do what he wants, but Katarina wasn't even in here. I think that's kind of the sad thing, right? Is you're like, oh man, we could totally do this, and then surprise, it's the Shun Police.
Yes. And well, seems like Julius is broken free from the Shun Police in this one because he is all over the place.
Yeah.
So the question then becomes, University of Michigan, well, I wasn't going to say what do they do to win this. Baron is a good way to do it.
Yeah.
Getting those empowered minions finally break through. You can see that there's no vision of the Baron hit right now. And once again, Julius is on the prowl looking for someone. Hey, I dare you to check this brush. There's no way we're doing Baron.
I mean, I think you can really kind of pick your poison at this point, right?
Yeah.
You know, it's like, do you want to die by Baron? Do you want to die by face checking into brush? And, you know, OSU, 14,000 gold down, doing their best to kind of make it happen. You know, it would have to take some pretty insane dives and some pretty mismanaged cooldowns. But, you know, unlike last game where OSU was diving in with a really strong front line that wasn't able to clinch it, you are diving in with so many people that, like, okay, one of you dies in a kamikaze blaze of glory, right? The rest of you are there to finish the job. I think that's why, you know, Kha'Zix Katarina was actually very widely played by Fnatic back in Season 2.
Whoa, flash knock up onto Arun. That's the Monsoon. Perhaps a bit too soon as Julius goes in.
I'm going to be sick.
Goodness gracious, the damage.
What are you doing?
And then he comes out the other side somehow. He's taking the turret right now. Julius, the kills. Think of the streak.
Arun still making it happen, though. Arun is the homie this game. Just like, in the face of extreme adversity, ends up with 5 kills on Maokai. Wow, but that half the time of our last game.
Yeah.
We were talking about maybe one.